It is now time for question period. The Leader of Her Majesty's Loyal Opposition.
Mr. Speaker, my question is for the Premier. The government's 2014 budget made a spending commitment for infrastructure of $130 billion. In that budget, the spending commitment was fully costed, with no mention of the Hydro One fire sale. The 2015 budget made the same spending commitment of $130 billion, but included the proceeds from the Hydro One fire sale. So, Mr. Speaker, what happened? How does this Premier justify the fire sale of Hydro One, saying it's for infrastructure, when there's not one iota of a difference between what they're spending in 2014 and what they're spending now?
Mr. Speaker, well, go Blue Jays. let me just begin by saying to the Leader of the Opposition that we've always been clear that we needed to look at our assets, to leverage current assets in order to be able to invest in the assets that we need for now and for the future, Mr. Speaker. If we don't invest in the roads and the bridges and the transit systems and the water systems and the schools and the hospitals around this province that that we know are needed by communities, Mr. Speaker, we're not going to be able to compete. We're not going to be as productive as we should be, and communities are not going to be able to thrive, and businesses are not going to be able to expand. Infrastructure is fundamental to our economic growth, Mr. Speaker. It always has been. It has been neglected in the past. We are making the investments necessary in order to be able to go forward, Mr. Speaker.
Supplementary.
Mr. Speaker, again for the Premier, no one believes the spin that the Hydro One fire sale is going for infrastructure. In 2014, the Premier said she would spend $130 billion in her budget, and they laid out how they're going to pay for it. Now the Liberals claim the $4 billion from the Hydro One fire sale is going to pay for infrastructure. An editorial in the Ottawa Citizen reads, "A reasonable person might wonder why we need to sell most of a significant public asset just to keep doing what we've been doing before. The real answer, I suspect, is that it will enable the government to quietly shift existing money to help reduce their deficit or pay for their spending programs." Mr. Speaker, when will the Premier admit the fire sale of Hydro One is just and entirely to pay for their own mismanagement?
Thank you, Premier.
Well, Mr. Speaker, you know, the assumption in that, in fact, explicitly stated in that question, is that we are doing exactly what has been done by previous governments. That's not true, Mr. Speaker. Previous governments didn't invest in infrastructure. And in fact, Mr. Speaker, when we came into office in 2003, what the previous government—
I'm not getting things quiet for somebody to throw their jabs at.
He came into office in 2003, Mr. Speaker. The fact is that there was a lag, there was a neglect in the investment in infrastructure that had been a hallmark of the previous government, including, Mr. Speaker, filling in the hole along Eglinton Avenue, where there would have been a subway. We would have had a subway along Eglinton by now if that government hadn't filled.
Thank you. The member from Prince Edward Hastings will come to order. Final supplementary.
Mr. Speaker, again for the Premier, the $130 billion commitment in 2015 wasn't new. It was fully costed in 2014. The only difference between the 2014 infrastructure commitment and the one in 2015 is a surprise fire sale of Hydro One. The Liberal budget is simply a shell game. Everyone in Ontario knows it's a shell game.
President and Treasury Board, come to order.
Mr. Speaker, my question is, what is the money really going for? Is it going for e-health? Is it going to make up for Orange? Is it going for the gas plants? Mr. Speaker, are you doing this fire sale to pay for your own scandals and incompetence?
Premier?
Every time the Leader of the Opposition says the word fire sale, I think he's talking about the 407, Mr. Speaker. To make the investments that we need to make, we had to look at current assets, Mr. Speaker, and that's why we asked to ask Ed Clark to look at our current assets and to give us advice on how to leverage them to invest in new infrastructure, Mr. Speaker. That was always part of our plan, Mr. Speaker. We were very clear about it, and that is what we're doing. The fact it is.
The member from Nipissing and the member from Renfrew come to order. Carry on.
Right. Mr. Speaker, we have talked about the assets and the need to leverage assets from the time we put our plan in place, Mr. Speaker. It was in our budget. It was in our election platform. We're moving forward so we can make the investments that are needed in this province, Mr. Speaker.
The Leader of the Opposition.
Mr. Speaker, my question is for the Minister of Agriculture, Food and Rural Affairs. This week, the Minister stood in the House and spoke of the importance of agriculture in the province, and I commend the Minister for recognizing that during Ontario Agriculture Week. But in his capacity, the Minister should be fighting for rural Ontario at the Cabinet table, making rural voices heard. Instead, the Minister has ignored the plea from 166 municipalities, the vast majority in rural Ontario, who have said unequivocally the fire sale of Hydro One is a bad deal for rural Ontario.
Deputy
the Minister knows this fire sale is a bad deal for rural Ontario. Mr. Speaker, when will the Minister stand up for the people of rural Ontario and tell his Premier why this is a bad deal for rural Ontario?
Thank you.
Well, thanks.
I'm still standing. No, I'm still standing.
Thanks very much, Mr. Speaker. And you know, the question from the Leader of the Opposition is like a fastball down the middle of the plate. And let me tell you why. I was a city councillor in Peterborough 1998-99 when the government. Mr. Speaker, I went through what was called then the who does what exercise, but anybody that served a municipal council during that period of time knows exactly what it was. It was the who got done in exercise. That party over there in Eastern Ontario downloaded 43% of all the roads and bridges in Eastern Ontario. Shame on them for not funding that and dumping it down.
You see it, please? You see it, please? 12 years. Order. Order. Supplementary.
I'd be embarrassed that I hadn't done anything.
Mr. Speaker, again to the Minister of Agriculture first. The minister kept quiet on the neonic pesticides issue, and now he sits silent on the Hydro One fire sale while rural municipalities are pleading for him to stand up for rural Ontario. Interesting, Mr. Speaker, that among the 166 municipalities that say this is a bad deal for Ontario is Peterborough and Peterborough County. In the past, the minister's on the record saying he would keep Hydro One in public hands. The minister knows that his own constituents and over 70% of residents in Ontario are against this bad deal. So, Mr. Speaker, my question to the minister is, will he finally stand up for his constituents in Peterborough, listen to his city council, and say this is a bad deal for rural Ontario?
You see it, please? You see it, please? Thank you. Minister?
The Leader of the Opposition just pitched another fastball down the middle of the plate. And I'd like to report, Mr. Speaker, too. I'd like to speak what the Leader of the Opposition said May 5, 2015. I generally believe that the private sector can do a better job than the public sector. I generally think market conditions should be helpful for a lot of government agencies.
Who said that?
And then on May 15th, I obviously like market conditions. I know how the private sector runs a business, runs like a business. Mr. Speaker, he should ask me another question, the third ball down the middle of the plate.
Final supplementary.
Mr. Speaker, again for the minister. We know the.
I'm actually trying to get the member from Niagara West, Glenbrook. I'm trying to get the attention of them, and you're not helping. No. Don't engage. Don't engage. Please ask your question.
Speaker, again to the Minister of Agriculture. We know the minister won't stand up for rural Ontario on the neo-NIC ban. We know the minister will not stand up for his own constituents in Peterborough by virtue of the motion passed by Peterborough City Council. But maybe he can support agriculture in Ontario.
The member from Eglinton Lawrence, second time.
Mr. Speaker, I'm asking the Minister of Agriculture if he will support the incredible work by the member for Huron-Bruce, who is putting forward a motion to recognize the importance of agriculture and food literacy and introduce it into the high schools. Mr. Speaker, will the minister support this great motion today?
Thank you, Minister.
Mr. Speaker, I think the Leader of the Opposition just walked in the winning run this afternoon against the Texas Rangers with that question. Now, and the answer is simple. Yes. Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker.
Thank you. No question, the Leader of the Third Party.
Thank you, Speaker, and I'm proud to be wearing my blue and white today to support the Blue Jays. Speaker, my question is to the Premier. The people of Ontario don't want this Premier to sell off our hydro system, our public hydro system. They have been writing, they have been signing petitions, they have been demonstrating, Speaker, but this Premier has ignored them and has ignored their legitimate concerns. She promised to consult, but so far she's only consulting with wealthy investors. She promised to listen, but so far she's only listening to her embedded banker, Speaker. This Premier doesn't care what the people of Ontario think. Why is she ignoring Ontarians and plowing ahead with the sell-off of Hydro One against the public's wishes?
Thank you. Premier.
Well, Mr. Speaker, as the Leader of the Third Party knows full well, what we have said is we are going to broaden the ownership in Hydro One. And I'm sure when she's talking to folks in communities, she makes it clear that that is a portion of the electricity system in Ontario, Mr. Speaker, that it's part of the distribution system, Mr. Speaker, and the transmission system, and that that it is a system that is already mixed in terms of private and public deliverers. I'm sure she makes that clear, Mr. Speaker. I'm sure she also makes it clear that we said we were going to leverage existing assets, Mr. Speaker, in order to invest in the infrastructure assets that we know we need into the future, Mr. Speaker, because that's what this is about. It's about the roads and the bridges, the water systems around the province,
answer.
Transit that we know we need in order to be able to compete globally.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Well, what I can tell you for sure, Speaker, is the people of Ontario do darn well know what Hydro One is, and they don't want it sold off. The Premier thinks she knows better than Ontarians, though, Speaker. Most Ontarians oppose the sell-off of Hydro One. Meanwhile, a significant majority of Ontarians also favour modest increases to the taxes of our largest corporation, Speaker. The government's own report showed that by raising corporate tax rates by 1%, they could raise $700 million a year. That's almost double the annual expenditure that they expect to make through their sell-off of Hydro One, Speaker. Why is this Premier plowing ahead with this unnecessary sell-off against the will of Ontarians?
Question. Thank you.
Premier. Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. So, again, as the Leader of the Third Party knows, every municipal leader in this province, Mr. Speaker, is looking to the provincial government and also to the federal government, quite frankly, for investments in infrastructure, Mr. Speaker. They know that they need to be able to make those investments. They can't do it on their own, Mr. Speaker. They know they need a partner in the provincial government to invest in provincial infrastructure that links our communities and to work with municipalities to make those investments, Mr. Speaker. The Leader of the Third Party talks about tax increases, Mr. Speaker. She knows that in our budget, we did increase taxes, Mr. Speaker. She also knows that when she talks about a corporate tax hike, she's not talking about it in the context of a competitive business environment, because that doesn't seem to be a concern of hers, Mr. Speaker. She also knows that she has spent that corporate tax hike 50 times. She spent it on education, she spent it on social services, she spent it on infrastructure, Mr. Speaker.
Thank you.
Speaker, this Premier knows that over 170 municipal leaders have said no to the sell-off of Hydro One. And this Premier knows, Speaker, that our tax rate, our combined corporate tax rate here in the province of Ontario, is lower than that of Alabama, and she should be ashamed of that, Speaker, not not valid. The Premier is presenting the people of Ontario with a false choice because the fact is that she had a choice, Speaker. She could have chosen to ask the most profitable corporations to pay just a little bit more. This would allow us to build the transit and the infrastructure that this province so desperately needs. But instead, she is cynically insisting on selling off Hydro One. When will the Premier do the right thing? Put a stop to this wrong-headed privatization.
Question?
Just stop this direction and make a better choice for the people of Ontario and the generations to come.
Thank you. Be seated, please. Be seated, please. Thank you. Premier.
Speaker, the NDP is presenting the people of Ontario with a mythical solution.
Mythical.
The fact is, this is the kind of magical thinking that would not result in the building of transit, Mr. Speaker, because every time there is a challenge put forward in terms of revenue that's needed, in terms of investment that's needed, whether it's in transit, whether it's in roads and bridges, whether it's in health care, whether it's in education, Mr. Speaker, the leader of the third party trots out the same number, Mr. Speaker, and the same solution. The reality is that under her lack of a plan. With her lack of a plan, Mr. Speaker, there would be no new alignment of Highway 7 between Kitchener and Guelph. There would be no Highway 401 improvements in London and Highway 417 in Ottawa. There would be no Mailey Drive extension in Sudbury, Mr. Speaker, because you cannot do any of those things without the funding to make the improvements.
New question, maybe the third party.
Every time this Premier needs money, she picks the pockets of everyday Ontarians and makes the society less fair in Ontario, Speaker. Speaker, my question is for the Premier. The Trans-Pacific Partnership has a lot of people very worried. This Premier has been happy to hurl attacks at Stephen Harper when it suits her federal leader's purpose, but on his far-reaching secret trade deal, she's suddenly excited by Harper's plans. Despite the fact that the TPP could not only roll back environmental progress made under previous agreements, it could also restrict internet freedom, Speaker. Open Media has said, quote, that the TPP will criminalize our online activities, censor the web, and cost everyday users money. The people of Ontario want to know, Speaker, at what point will this Premier actually draw a line and say enough to the dangerous provisions in Harper's TPP?
Thank you.
Mr. Speaker, the leader of the third party knows that there is a period of ratification now as the details of the plan are made clear. What I have said, Mr. Speaker, is that we have some concerns. We absolutely do have some concerns. We have some concerns about agriculture and what the implications of the agreement would mean. We have concerns about the auto parts sector, Mr. Speaker. Obviously, the auto industry is extremely important to the people of Ontario, and we have some concerns about what the implications would be. But, Mr. Speaker, there are also opportunities, and if you look across the country, there are opportunities for industry in this country to find new markets, Mr. Speaker, and to be able to expand. So we are taking a cautious approach, Mr. Speaker, but we are not irresponsibly washing our hands of opportunities that may exist for the people of Ontario.
Thank you.
Speaker, economists warn that the TPP could drive away one quarter of Canada's auto manufacturing. Guess what, Speaker? That's mostly in Ontario. The fact that Stephen Harper is throwing $1 billion at the auto sector shows very clearly that even he knows it will be bad for manufacturing. And Jim Balsillie, the founder of BlackBerry, is sounding alarm bells about the impact of the TPP on the tech sector, Speaker. The people of Ontario, of this province, deserve to know why their premier is jumping on the bandwagon with her federal leader to back this bad trade deal. Why is the Premier of this province, Speaker, willing to accept a deal that kills 20,000 jobs in Ontario's auto sector and threatens Ontario's burgeoning tech sector?
Thank you.
Mr.
Mr. Speaker, not jumping on a bandwagon, not completely supportive, Mr. Speaker. I have said that we are concerned about certain areas in the deal, Mr. Speaker. We need to see the language. We need to understand exactly what the details are, Mr. Speaker. We need to understand the implications for industry in Ontario. But, Mr. Speaker, we also need to know where there are opportunities. And, Mr. Speaker, this is an agreement that was forged for the whole country, Mr. Speaker. And I understand that we are here in Ontario. It is my job to stand up for the people and the industries in this province, and I will do that, Mr. Speaker. But we also have to understand that we're part of a federation, Mr. Speaker, and we need to understand what the implications and the opportunities are for all provinces and territories across the country. So, Mr. Speaker, I'm not jumping on a bandwagon. I'm saying let's look at it, let's figure out where the cautions are, and let's figure out where the opportunities are.
She cannot have it both ways. She can't say one thing to the Empire Club and say something totally opposite in this legislature. The chorus of voices against the TPP is growing. Prominent U.S. legislators and former Secretary of State Hillary Clinton have now stated their opposition to the TPP because it will unfairly benefit big U.S. drug companies at the expense of patients, Speaker, and because it will push North American wages down even further. Ontario families are already struggling with stagnant wages and cannot afford to be squeezed further, Speaker. At what point will the Premier of this province stop going along with her federal leader and Stephen Harper in their race to the bottom and instead stand up for Ontarians?
Well, Mr. Speaker, I believe that saying that there are cautions that we have to be very clear about in this trade deal, Mr. Speaker, understanding that there may be sectors like the auto sector, like the supply-managed sector, Mr. Speaker, where we have to be very, very careful that there are supports in place. I think that is standing up for the people of Ontario. I also think it's standing up for the people of Ontario when, if there is an opportunity for us to strengthen our export capacity, Mr. Speaker, to find markets that are going to help our businesses to grow, I think that's standing up for the people of Ontario as well, Mr. Speaker. And the fact that the leader of the third party can't deal with that complexity is not the problem of the people of Ontario. It is complex. It is a complex global economy.
Answer.
And the sooner she discovers that, the better off we all are.
Be seated, please. Be seated, please. Thank you. I'm expecting everyone to do that. When I stand, you stop. New question, the member from Haliburton Court, the next stop.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. My question is to the Premier. Last week, after the senseless violence that struck the Ottawa Valley, I asked the Attorney General just how many convicted offenders are released despite the refusal to sign probation orders. The Attorney General said she didn't know. In January 2014, Anastasia Kuzak went to the OPP because Mr. Barutsky violated his probation order, broke into her home, and violently beat her. Mr. Kuzak said that she thought he was going to kill her. His violent past should have raised every conceivable red flag. Just 9 months after Mr. Barutsky was released on probation, Anastasia Kuzak, Natalie Warmerdam, and Carol Colton are dead, allegedly at his hands. Mr. Speaker, why has the Premier failed in her commitment to combating domestic violence and take immediate action to ensure violent offenders are more closely monitored?
Mr. Speaker, I know the Minister of Community Safety and Correctional Services is going to want to comment in the supplementary. What I want to just say is that this was a horrible, horrible tragedy. And when it happened, it was shocking to everyone involved, and my heart absolutely goes out to all of the families, and quite frankly, to all of the communities. It was just a terrible tragedy. And Mr. Speaker, it highlights why it's so important that we all work together, whether it's on the Select Committee, Mr. Speaker, or the changes that we are going to be bringing forward to legislation to make sure that there are supports for victims, that there are more protections put in place for people who are dealing dealing with sexual assault and violence and helping them to come forward, Mr. Speaker. And I, as I say, the Minister of Community Safety and Correctional Services will respond to the supplementary.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. It absolutely was a tragedy, and we could have tried to prevent it. So this government has failed to protect these three innocent
women
from a dangerous repeat offender who refused to comply with any court-ordered restrictions. This government is now putting more women at risk with its decision to cut the length of the Partner Assault Response Program from 16 weeks to 12 weeks because there are more than 3,000 offenders who are on the wait list. 3 years ago, the Domestic Violence Death Review Committee compiled a list of risk factors for enhanced assessment and safety, factors that the government should have acted on to prevent the murders of Anastasia, Natalia, and Carol. Their families, at the very least, deserve an apology and an explanation. Mr. Speaker, will the Premier explain why she's failing to act on the province's own committee's report to prevent the victims of domestic violence?
Thank you very much, Speaker, and I also want to echo the Premier and all members of this House is that the kind of incident that took place a few weeks ago in Wilno is shocking and is unacceptable. Speaker, we know that domestic violence is despicable and absolutely unacceptable anywhere in Ontario. Everyone, Speaker, has the right to feel safe in their home and in their community. And, Speaker, all police services in Ontario are required to have policies and procedures in place for managing domestic violence investigations. To support police services across the province, the Ministry of Community Safety and Correctional Services have developed the Domestic Violence Occurrences Guideline, and police services in Ontario have designated domestic violence coordinator to provide a consistent approach for responding to domestic violence incidents. Not to mention, Speaker, we are putting emphasis on training through the Ontario Police College to make sure that we've got appropriate training for our police officers to avoid domestic violence.
Thank you. No question. The member from Essex.
Thank you, Speaker. My question is for the Premier. Speaker, 20,000 good-paying manufacturing jobs in the auto sector and manufacturing sectors are estimated to be at risk from the secretive Trans-Pacific Partnership trade agreement that the leader of the Liberal Party plans on waiting and seeing about. But let me localize this for you, Speaker. In my community of Windsor and Essex County, that's as many as 3,000 good-paying manufacturing jobs, a community that is already reeling from the highest unemployment rate in Canada, one that's seen the exodus of good-paying manufacturing jobs to the lowest wage jurisdictions on the planet over the last 10 years. Speaker, is the Premier prepared to tell the people of my community of Windsor and Essex County that she will indeed wait and see what happens with the Trans-Pacific Partnership?
Thank you.
Well, Mr. Speaker, there was no waiting and seeing. We had the Minister of Agriculture and Rural Affairs go to Atlanta, where the deal was being finalized, Mr. Speaker, to express concerns, to have a meeting with the federal minister, because as the member knows, provinces and territories were not included by the federal government in the discussions, Mr. Speaker. They weren't consulted with. We didn't have any idea of where they were going. We didn't have information about what the issues were going to be at the table, Mr. Speaker, so we had to insert ourselves into the process, which is why the minister went to Atlanta. So, Mr. Speaker, we are not being passive in this in any way, nor are we being passive in terms of supporting our industries, Mr. Speaker. We are very, very actively engaged with businesses across the province to work with them so that they can thrive. And, you know, part of that, Mr. Speaker, to go back to the question by the leader, his leader, we're investing in infrastructure that's needed by communities all across the
country. Thank you, Speaker. The Premier has repeatedly said that she doesn't know what to expect from the TPP trade agreement, but she can't expect the people of Windsor and Essex County with a 9.5% unemployment rate to just wait and see. Stephen Harper said in September that the auto industry wouldn't like what was in the TPP trade agreement. That's why he's bracing for this impact with money announcements. Speaker, at what point will the Premier admit that she has absolutely no idea how to help the people of Windsor and Essex County withstand another hit from the expected TPP trade agreement.
I've said in every answer that I've given on this agreement that we have a concern about the auto sector, Mr. Speaker. There's no doubt about that, and we have been very clear. But, Mr. Speaker, the deal has been negotiated by the federal government. The deal has been negotiated without consultation with the premiers of the provinces and the territories. So, Mr. Speaker, it is my responsibility to make sure that we put forward the cautions, that we make sure that the federal government understand that we are at risk in terms of a number of our sectors, Mr. Speaker. Beyond that, it is very important that where there are opportunities for our industries to grow, we take advantage of those opportunities, Mr. Speaker. And we have to work with the federal government,
Answer.
Who has negotiated this deal, Mr. Speaker, to make that sure that both those things happen, the protections and the opportunities.
Thank you. Question. The member for Peace and the Arts.
Answers. What's the
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. My question is for the Minister of Children and Youth Services. Speaker, last Wednesday I picked up the Toronto Star and read about a number of changes that will benefit children and youth in care. I understand that these changes are making it easier to connect these vulnerable young people with a more permanent living situation and hopefully a place to call home. And in an editorial this weekend, the Star applauded these changes and saying, and I quote, "It's not just the right thing for the province to give these kids a helping hand. It's a fiscally prudent move that will make a big difference in their lives as they become adults." In my community of Kingston and the Islands, the wonderful dedicated staff and volunteers at Family and Children's Services of Frontenac, Lennox and Addington work so hard to provide safe and nurturing environments for more than 350 young people under their care, and I know that they would also be interested in learning more about these changes.
Question.
Through you, Mr. Speaker, can the minister please inform the House on the important changes she announced last week?
Thank you. Minister of Children and Youth Services.
Thank you, Speaker, and I want to thank the member from Kingston and the Islands for taking such an active interest in what's going on in terms of adoption in Ontario. It's an excellent question. And, Speaker, we made these changes because we recognize there's a need to do more. There's a need to do more, excuse me, to support permanency in our child welfare system. Speaker, the research is very, very clear. Children experience better outcomes when they have a stable and permanent living situation. That's why we're making these changes to strengthen the adoption system so more children and youth can find forever families. Among the specific steps we're taking are measures to make it easier for traditionally harder to place children to be adopted. And, Mr. Speaker, we're supporting families to adopt older children, and we're expanding eligibility for our adoption subsidies so that more children can be connected to their forever family. This is great news for children in care in Ontario.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and I'd like to thank the minister for the update and for this exciting news. I'm glad that more children in care will be connected with a permanent and stable living situation and benefit from the stability and care of a family. I greatly admire the foster parents who strive to make a positive difference in the lives of so many deserving children and youth, and I know that sometimes it can be hard adjustment as some children and youth are coping with emotional and/or behavioral challenges. That is one reason why proper stability, support, and of course, friendship and affection are so important. I am proud that our government is supporting families in this way. I'm also glad to read on Twitter that these changes that the
Question.
Provincial Advocate for Children and Youth supports. Can the minister please explain how the changes she announced will help children focus on their education?
Thank you. Sir.
Thanks again, Speaker. There's a number of changes in the announcement from last week that we're all very proud of, but I want to talk about children in care who are not progressing on the same timeline for finishing high school as children who live with family, Speaker. I think we all agree it's our responsibility to ensure these young people are given every opportunity to succeed. And quite often that happens and starts with a high school diploma. So last week we announced funding that allows Crown wards to stay with their foster families past the age of 18 while they finish school. This means they'll be able to maintain the stability necessary to finish high school without disruption to their home environment. Mr. Speaker, we heard from youth and we heard from the Child and Youth advocate that this was the right thing to do.
Answer.
And we absolutely agree. It's the right thing for our children and youth, and we're very, very proud to be doing this.
Thank you. Your question, the member from Thorn Hill.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. And of course, go Jays, go. We're all very excited for this afternoon. My question is directed to the Minister of Health. Mr. Speaker, some of us may recall way back in the year 2000, the negotiation of doctor compensation when the Ontario government agreed to cover medical liability protection costs in exchange for direct remuneration. Mr. Speaker, this was considered a barter system, paying the soaring malpractice insurance costs in exchange for less taxpayer money to doctors. With this government's repeated cuts to doctors' service fees, coupled with the Liberal government's proposed Ontario retirement pension plan, is this government prepared to cover the high pension costs for medical staff in doctors' offices as you did for medical liability protection costs?
Good question. Minister of Health and Long-Term Care.
Well, thank you, Mr. Speaker. I appreciate the question. It's got many parts to it. You know, I'm proud that as part of our agreement with past agreements with the OMA, we continue to reimburse them for a portion of their liability insurance. I think that that's something, in fact, it goes all the way back to the mid-1980s and something that every government since then has supported. But, you know, I'm not sure exactly where the member opposite is trying to go. Our physicians, and I say this with pride being one of them, our physicians in this province are, as they should be, the best paid in Canada. We have some of the brightest minds, the best physicians and experts providing the highest quality of health care to this province, and that's as it should be. So we're obviously in a difficult financial time. We've asked our doctors to take a modest reduction in the fees that we provide
for
the services that they provide to Ontarians, but they are the best paid in this country. Probably North America, possibly beyond. That will remain as such, Mr. Speaker.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Thank you, Ms. Again, to the Minister of Health. And I would just say that I think that a lot of doctors would disagree with some of your comments. But Minister, the Minister claims that there will be no new money available to pay our doctors. This Liberal government expects the total amount paid to all our doctors collectively to remain the same year after year, with no extra money to account for our increasing population, our aging population, up-to-date medical treatments, or the rising cost of running a clinic. We certainly do not hear, for example, the Minister of Education speak in these terms. Imagine a neighbourhood school with a specific budget for teacher salaries. Now imagine the same school accepting 60 more students and requiring two new teachers. No one would consider it reasonable to require all the teachers at the school to give up a portion of their salaries to fund the two new teachers. Why, then, does the Minister of Health expect doctors to give up a portion of their fees?
Mr. Speaker, I'm proud to say as well that the average compensation for our doctors has gone up by 60% since we took office. And in fact, our budget, the envelope available for physicians, isn't remaining the same. It's going up by 1.25% this year. It's going up by 1.25% next year. It is increasing. But I have to say to the member opposite that I would have hoped she'd also reference our other health care professionals, our PSWs, which we've increased their wages, our nurse practitioners, that also we have substantial issues in recruitment and retention of our nurse practitioners and other health care professionals. We have to provide more funds, as we've committed to do, to home care, to mental health services as well. So we're asking our doctors, in the face of a 60% increase, far in excess of any health care professional, to actually take a pause, a modest reduction, so we can attend to those other priorities.
New question, the member from Windsor West.
Thank you, Speaker. My question is to the Premier. Last November, the Liberal caucus, including the Minister of Education, voted to support the NDP's motion calling for the province to work with the federal government to provide low-cost childcare spaces. However, after it was clear that the NDP was the only willing federal partner ready to support $15 a day childcare, the Premier decided to put partisan Liberal interests.
Stop the clock. Order. Finish, please.
The Premier decided to put partisan Liberal interests ahead of the needs of Ontario families.
I wrote to the Premier in August asking whether she intended to honour or break the commitment her government made last year. She has not answered. So I ask again, will the Premier honour or break her government's commitment to ensure that new childcare spaces in Ontario will cost no more than $15 a day?
Well, Mr. Speaker, I do appreciate the steady stream of questions from the Mulcare campaign. It's very encouraging, Mr. Speaker. I would say to the member, Mr. Speaker, that you know it is not at all clear what a Mulcair plan for childcare would actually cost the province of Ontario, Mr. Speaker. So of course we have made significant investments in childcare and will continue to do so, Mr. Speaker. Childcare funding has increased in Ontario from $532.4 million to close to over $1 billion. That's a 90% increase, Mr. Speaker. We are committed to childcare. We understand how important it is, Mr. Speaker, and we will continue to
remember
remain
from
committed
Hamilton
to childcare.
Come to order. Supplementary.
It sounds to me like that the Premier is not willing to honour her commitment.
Minister of Transportation.
Minister of Education.
Second time.
In order to sustain childcare spaces, you need good neighbourhood schools. Less than a week ago, the government re-announced a promise to provide childcare that is close to home, meaning they would be in schools. But since 2011, the minister has forced the closure of at least 88 schools across the province. Five schools in Windsor, Essex are currently at risk of immediate closure. How can the minister promise childcare spaces in schools when she is actively forcing the closure of good community schools?
Education.
Minister of Education.
Yes, and I was very pleased last week to announce the beginning of a program for investment in new childcare spaces, about 4,000 new childcare spaces. We did the first 13 of those childcares. And what the member opposite is missing, that in some cases, what we are doing is actually creating the opportunity to take a child care that was in the community and move it to a school, or take a child care that was previously located in one school and build it in a new school. And that's something that we intend to continue doing. Some of those spaces are for 4- and 5-year-olds, before and after care. The particular group of spaces we announced last week are actually for preschoolers. In fact, we announced almost 800 new spaces just last week alone.
Your question, the member from Scarborough Agincourt.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. My question is for the Minister of Labour. Women and men should be equally footing in today's society. Early this week, our Premier spoke about a group of inspiring Canadians, the Famous Five, who tirelessly advocate for women's rights. Our government has demonstrated its commitment to women's equality by helping women better access to workforce through major investment in education, training programs, full-day kindergarten and childcare, and also through the work of Pay Equity Commission, Ontario's Women's Directorate and the Ontario Human Rights Commission. These independent provincial agencies help to increase economic security of women and eliminate systemic barriers. However, Mr. Speaker, each day in my riding of Scarborough Agincourt, I hear the same issues. There's a wage gap between genders that unfairly disadvantage women in our province.
Question.
Speaker, through you to the minister, what is being done to ensure that Ontarians move forward eliminating the wage gap?
Good question.
Thank you, Minister of Labour.
Thank you, Speaker. I'd like to thank the member for this very, very important question on a very important issue. Speaker, the sad fact is women on average in Ontario do not earn as much as men, and that needs to change. As a member knows, Speaker, Minister McCharles and I previously announced our Gender Wage Gap Strategy Steering Committee. The panel's made up of two external advisors, Linda Davis, the past president of the Business and Professional Women's Club of Ontario. Dr. Parthibial Singh is a leading expert in human resource management and in labour relations. We've got the Pay Equity Commissioner for Ontario, Emmanuela Hynek, and Nancy Austin from my own ministry. The member's question could not have come at a better time, Speaker. Today we're releasing our consultation paper announcing the kickoff of October 26th right across Ontario. Speaker, This is a very important issue whose time has come.
Answer.
We're committed to developing a strategy that's going to close the wage gap between men and women.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Thank you, Speaker. Thank you to the minister for the answer. I'm happy the consultation will begin shortly, and I'm looking forward to the recommendations that were put forward during this process. I also know, Mr. Speaker, this is a complex issue caused by many different factors. I know that all women across economic spectrums are affected by the wage gap, but the gap is more pronounced for women who are minorities, Aboriginals, newcomers, or living with disabilities. Last Saturday, Mr. Speaker, I hosted a health and government fair in my riding of Scarborough-Agincourt, and I heard a number of issues from new Canadians about the wage gap issue. The existence of a gender wage gap is indicative of barriers facing women that prevent them from making full contribution to the provincial economy. Mr. Speaker, through you to the minister, can he please inform the House the goals of the steering committees and the steps it will take to achieve these
question.
Goals?
Question. Thank you. Minister.
Thank you, Speaker. I'd like to thank the member again for that excellent question. Our goal, clearly, is to increase fairness for women in Ontario by closing the gender wage gap. To help us do that, the consultations are going to examine ways that government, business, labour, other organizations, even individuals, can work together to identify opportunities, remove the barriers, and close that gender wage gap. It's going to examine the role of women at work in their families, in their communities, and how this impacts on the gap. Following the consultation, Speaker, the committee will be responsible for providing me, along with the minister responsible for women's issues, with recommendations that can assist us in achieving the goal we all have of closing the gender wage gap in Ontario. I look forward to seeing the recommendations that come back from this committee, taking the next step necessary to make Ontario a fairer province. Speaker, as I said earlier, this is an issue whose time has come. We aim to deal with
it. Thank you. New question, the member from Perry Sound Muskoka.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. My question is to the Attorney General through the Speaker. Muskoka Victim Services usage is growing exponentially. Over the past 5 years alone, the yearly caseload jumped from 185 to 822 individuals.
Wow.
That's a 444% increase.
Wow.
This local organization provides critical, immediate support for individuals and families faced with challenges following crime or tragic events. They do tremendous work. Speaker, because of the changes the Liberal government made to the funding model, Muskoka Victim Services is being forced to do more with less. A funding cut of 10% has left the organization scrambling to find ways to effectively serve their clients. Speaker, will the minister explain why the government cut funding to Muskoka Victim Services?
Thank you. Attorney General.
It's really a good question because, you know, in the past there was no consistency with these programs. So a few years ago we did review the program. We did analyze it, and we are now attributing the money to the request for service. So, but we know that in rural community and in the north, you know, the population is not there, but they need the service. So we have a special addition in the envelope for rural and northern community. So if and it's being reviewed every year, and if there is an increase, then the envelope is readjusted. So I'll say to the member, please you know, speak to me, and I will give more detail with the information in hand.
Thank you
very much.
Supplementary.
Again, through the Speaker to the Attorney General, as the trend shows, demand is increasing for local services provided for victims. With the hard work of the organization, over 50 volunteers that are doing their best to meet the increasing demand. Muskoka Victim Services has had to resort to producing a fundraising video to help make up their budget shortfall.
Wow.
Speaker, shouldn't increasing access to victim services be a priority for the Liberal government, regardless of where an Ontario person chooses to live?
You think.
Attorney General.
Mr. Speaker, of course, you know, Victim Services is a very, very important program and support for those who need the service. So that is why in 2015 we created the Victim Crisis Assistance Ontario. And as I said in my previous answer, you know, we are not reducing the overall envelope. Instead, we are redistributing the funding to meet service demand. And under the new funding model, 28 of the 47 agencies that deliver this program receive an increase. But again, you know, this program, this service is revised regularly. And if there is an increase in the demand, the envelope will be increased. Thank you very much, Mr. President.
New question, the Leader of the Third Party.
Thank you, Speaker. My question is for the Premier. Last year, my colleague, the member for Hamilton Mountain, raised the issue of a young man, Cameron Laflamme, who has autism and requires intensive one-on-one care and the supports provided through a day program. The issue then was that he was about to get he was about to age out of school, and his mother, needing to work full-time, couldn't afford to put him into a day program. Happily, funding was provided, and Cameron received the care that he needed, and his mom was able to continue to work. But now the family's learned that the funds available are going to run out this November and will not cover the full annual cost of her son's day program after all. What exactly does the Premier expect this family to do if the funds aren't available, Speaker?
Minister of Children and Youth Services.
Minister of Children and Youth Services.
Thank you, Speaker, and I want to thank the member for the important question. And as always, as I do with the critic for Children and Youth Services from your party, I'm always happy to discuss cases with her to the extent I can. I can't get into specifics of a case here, of course, but we work, I think, very well in terms of identifying issues in her riding and other ridings, and our regional office often reaches out to the families who may need additional support. And I know very well that families caring for young people with autism face very unique challenges, Speaker. And we are very determined as a government to make further progress for these children and their families. And that's why our government, Speaker, invests nearly $190 million annually in autism services. And that's an increase of more than 300% since 2003. But we know there's more to
Thank
do.
You. Supplementary.
Well, Speaker, there's no doubt that this family was grateful that the work of the member from Hamilton Mountain with this minister helped resolve this case several months ago. But the problem is, this young man, Cameron Laflamme, has not been cured of autism. He still has autism, Speaker, and still needs the program. They're in crisis right now. They can't wait for any other solution. This young man has aged out of school. He's been placed in a day program that works, where he actually gets the care that he needs. The solution is clear. In fact, the minister helped find it. But not only are the Liberals pulling the rug out from under Cameron now, several months later, but they're failing thousands of families just like his. Cameron's mom can't quit her job in order to provide full-time support for him while waiting years for funding to come through. When is this government and this Premier going to commit to helping Cameron's family and others like them in a permanent way that helps them over time, not just for a small window?
Minister of Community and Social Services.
Minister of Community and Social Services.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. And certainly, just as my colleague, the Minister of Children and Youth, has said, in individual cases, of course, we would welcome further information. I'm not aware of this particular situation, but if the individual is now an adult, the individual needs to, and the family need to, consult with their local developmental service organization. And I would certainly urge the member to consult with my ministry. We are dedicated to ensuring that people have appropriate services. We acknowledge the great efforts that families and caregivers do play, the role that they play, and their commitment to the individual
Answer.
That they are caring for. And this is precisely why in our budget we did increase the budget for developmental services in this province.
New questions? Member for Kitchener Centre.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. My question is for the Minister of Health and Long-Term Care. Minister, infertility is a very serious medical issue that affects about 1 in 6 families here in Ontario. All different types of families want to know the joy of bringing a child into the world, but for some, they're not able to do so easily. Going through infertility treatments can be extremely trying on people, physically, emotionally, and financially, and I can tell you that I have a family member who knows this all too well. There have been a number of constituents in my riding of Kitchener Centre who've come to see me to ask how our government is supporting Ontarians who are facing these challenges as they try to conceive. Mr. Speaker, can the minister please tell us what our government is doing to support people who do want to grow their families who might be eligible for these services?
Minister of Health, Long-Term Care.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I want to thank the member from Kitchener Centre for this important question. It's an important question for thousands and thousands of Ontarians, Mr. Speaker. And she's absolutely right that the implications of infertility can be incredibly emotionally painful. And unless you've experienced it personally, you can't even begin to fathom the impact it can have on your life and that of your family. Until recently, access to fertility services has not been possible for many families because of the cost involved. But last week, I was extremely proud to announce that our government is expanding access for all Ontarians, regardless of sex or gender, sexual orientation or family status. Families come in all shapes and sizes in this province, Mr. Speaker, and this program will begin in December of this year. For women needing access to in vitro fertilization, our publicly funded program will continue to the cost of one cycle of IVF for all women under the age of 43, Mr. Speaker.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and I want to thank the minister for that answer. And I also want to add that family really is a gift every day. I'm very proud of my husband and my 3 awesome kids. Children are the future in this province and in our country, and everyone deserves a chance at parenthood. I know that my constituents in Kitchener Centre are going to be very encouraged to hear about this news that, as of December, that our government is going to be expanding access to all Ontarians who are struggling with infertility. Mr. Speaker, I'd like to ask the Minister of Health and Long-Term Care, what are we doing to ensure that fertility services are not only accessible and equitable, but are also safe?
Thank you, Minister.
Well, thank you, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, patient safety remains my number one priority as the Minister of Health and Long-Term Care. And Ontario will be working, the government will be working with the College of Physicians and Surgeons in order to provide stronger quality and safety oversight in the infertility sector. And our government's also working to improve safety and accessibility by expanding the definition of what one cycle of IVF is, Mr. Speaker. It means Ontario is going to contribute to the cost of one egg retrieval and also cover the transfer of the egg retrieval and also cover the transfer of all viable embryos one at a time, what's known as single embryo transfer, Mr. Speaker. By expanding this definition, patients get more chances to conceive and are more likely to have a safe, healthy pregnancy and delivery.
Answer.
In fact, single embryo transfer will dramatically reduce the chance of having multiple births, multiple pregnancies, and reduce the associated morbidity and risks and costs associated
with
that, Mr. Speaker.
The question, the member from Simcoe Gray.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. My question is for the Minister of Health and Long-Term Care. Mr. Speaker, according to Matthews House Hospice in my riding, the organization's unfunded 4 beds hosted 90 patients last year, affording them a dignified death. This year, Mr. Speaker, that number sits at 41 clients so far. In addition, its community hospice service supported 487 individuals last year, and to date, the organization has already been there for 380 clients. Mr. Speaker, the government has promised to fund 20 new hospices. They promised this in the 2014 budget, but Matthews House still isn't funded, and we're nearing the end of 2015. So, Mr. Speaker, can the minister tell this House when the government will step up and fully fund Matthews House Hospice in Alliston.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and I agree with the member opposite that by reputation, Matthews House does an extraordinary job for individuals and families in extremely trying, emotionally difficult circumstances. That's why we've made a commitment, as he mentioned, as government, to fund an additional 20 new hospices across Ontario. And I've asked my parliamentary assistant, John Fraser, to the member for Ottawa South, to actually lead a process where he's developing a palliative care strategy, renewing our end-of-life strategy. We were the first government to actually, in 2005, bring in an end-of-life strategy and attached more than $100 million to that contribution. We were the first government in this province actually to fund hospices in the first place. We've made that commitment. Matthews House has a great reputation. We're working directly, the ministry is, with Matthews, as well as with our Lynn, on this particular issue.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Mr. Speaker, back to the minister, and I thank the minister for that answer. And I also want to take the opportunity to also thank the honourable member for Ottawa South, Mr. Fraser, your parliamentary assistant, for touring Matthews House Hospice just recently. That was very good of him to meet with the staff and volunteers. But I remind you, Mr. Speaker, that other hospices in the area, for the south end of Simcoe County, the only hospice we have available is a couple of beds in Richmond Hill. When you see numbers like 80, 90 clients having a dignified death at Matthews House each year, year after year, you didn't have to pay for any of the bricks and mortar. You didn't pay for any of the overhead so far. You are paying for a couple of PSWs through home care. It's a good deal. They've diverted at least 60 people from dying in the local hospital, our very small Alliston Stevenson Memorial Hospital. It's a fraction of the cost to spend your last days in palliative care, in great care with the volunteers and staff at the local hospice rather than the hospital. So, Minister, I ask you again, when can you announce that you're going to fund Matthews House Hospice in Alliston?
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. And I want to, I think, as the member opposite has alluded to, I want to commend, I know there are a tremendous number of volunteers as well as the staff that work at the hospital that are doing an incredible job day in and day out for the individuals through Matthews House, the hospice that the member opposite is referring to. We've made a commitment to fund 20 more hospices. We stand by that commitment. I think the member opposite would appreciate that, as we had in 2005 with our end-of-life strategy, we're taking a very principled and coordinated approach to this across the province to identify those hospices like Matthews House that are deserving of the funding in this new commitment. I would request that both Matthews as well as the member opposite give my parliamentary assistant, the member for Ottawa South, that modest amount of time remaining for him to be able to consult. He mentioned that my PA had visited Matthews House, but give him that time to do the appropriate work so we can do this in a coordinated, proper fashion.
I want to add my own go Jays, go. But I would also have to make an announcement that I'm saddened. This is the last day for our Pages. I would like to offer us, on behalf of all of us, our gratitude to this wonderful group of Pages who have served us well. Point of order, the member from Eglinton Lawrence.
Mr. Speaker, I wonder, is it an order in this House for one member to take pictures of other members while they're in this House? I thought you made it very clear they were not to use camera devices to take pictures of members while they're in this House.
The member from Eglinton Lawrence is indeed mentioning a protocol and a convention that is not to be done. I've spoken about this before, that all devices are not to be used for anything else other than their personal use, and quietly and unassumingly. I would anticipate that all members are honourable in that way, that they would not use that for any purpose other than what has been agreed upon. I would also like to take the moment to point out to you that, regrettably, and I say this with all concern,
that if tweeting is going to be taking place about issues that happen in this House, I highly recommend that it be accurate. If it's going to happen, I would recommend against it. So there are no deferred votes. This House stands recess until 1 p.m. this afternoon.